Welcome, Sumita, to the conversation Women in Business. It's a four-part series that Vadvani Foundation, Sattva, and Upaya have come together to host, given women entrepreneurship is an extremely critical conversation, and we are leading up to Women's Day as well. So it's lovely to be able to have chats with interesting women entrepreneurs. So really looking forward to the conversation today. I'm Aarti, a co-founder and partner at Sattva Consulting, and lovely to chat with you. To start with, Sumita, we know that the problem here has been vast, right? Like, women's participation in the labor force has been falling steadily, and it's at an all-time low as per the 2018 data of 23%. Even among those who are working, we do know that over a third of them work on unpaid work. They have low wages. They have poor working conditions in unskilled jobs and so on. We also know that if women are enabled to work and women work, economies grow. And we do also know that women empowerment and gender equality is very critical to the growth and well-being of any economy. And in some sense, you've been working at the heart of it. Rangasutra is a community-owned craft company working with artisans from far-flung areas in India and different states, and going to serve the growing young urban lifestyle, right? And it's as well as celebrating India's rich heritage and traditions. It's also true that you run a very inclusive enterprise. These women that are enabled by Rangasutra own parts of the company. So it's been really interesting to see the journey that Rangasutra has had over the years. So would love for you to start with your story. What inspired you to start your own business? Did you always know you were going to be an entrepreneur? Did you always know you were going to work in impact?
To begin with my story, actually, I grew up in the city of Mumbai. And very frankly, I did not feel that being a woman or being a girl was any disadvantage. Because Bombay has that atmosphere where you're able to travel, you're able to go from one place to another without having someone to chaperone you, because the public transport system is so good. And Bombay is also a place where you find people from all over the country. So, from each state of the country. So you're really able to, for me, it gave, all through my growing up years in school and in college, it gave me a chance to really appreciate the vast diversity of our country, and the fact that we were celebrating all festivals. And then, of course, when I started going to college, I realized that each state had different kind of saris, so and textiles. So all that was really inspiring.
What were the kind of struggles you faced in your initial days? Right, craft is as much looked at as a hobby or a pastime rather than something that can be serious business. And how did you overcome these challenges? And were they actually something that would have equally applied to a male entrepreneur?
When I started Rangasutra and the fact that we decided to register it as a company, and therefore went into the business world, there was some bit of, I won't say patronizing attitude, but like not really taking me seriously. And including the others who were with me, most of whom were women. There were some men also when we started the company. But it was like, oh, where's, of course, the usual stuff? Where's your 3 years balance sheet? Do you have any collateral? And at that point, this was the year like 2005-ish. And at that point, I didn't have the understanding that I could say that, okay, we don't have monetary collateral, but we have all these wonderful women and men who've come together to form the company. So yes, that's the kind of fund, raising funds was the most. The biggest challenge in the beginning.
Got it. It's you built an enterprise out of women who probably stepped out of their homes for the first time, like you describe. While other countries like China have possibly been able to tap into the rural grassroots communities better for entrepreneurship, I'm not sure in India we've been yet able to see the gains of that. Would love for you to talk a little bit more about what it means to create women entrepreneurs out of communities in the rural areas. And two, how does women's economic empowerment translate to gender equality? It's not a direct correlation, right?
Yeah. So Arti, actually, yes, maybe China has tapped into it in a different way, but in India, at least from the time I started working in the social sector in the 80s and 90s, there was a lot of emphasis on forming collectives, as I mentioned, women's groups. The earliest, I believe, were, you know, what they call the Mahila Mandals, which were like groups of women who would even just get together to sing bhajans. And then, like we did in Urmul, then they started, talking about other things. Other problems that they faced, whether it was social, whether it was economic. And that's when the whole concept of this thrift and savings group started.
You know, as women entrepreneurs, we're always on, right? You're either a co-founder at work or you're a co-founder at home. You're planning, orchestrating, managing everything. How do you do that and how do you unwind?
What has really helped me is, and I discovered this about 5 years ago, I would say, or a little earlier, 7 years ago, is yoga. The practice of yoga and meditation has been my go-to to for any kind of, you know, if it's a problem which is troubling me. There's nothing like 6 rounds of Surya Namaskar will you know, I mean, to sort of calm down your mind and say that, you know, okay, let it be, the answer will come. You know, don't just, so that, then music, I love music, just listening to it. Since yoga helped me so much, I actually then also learned to be a yoga teacher. And that also was another education for me, you know, to be able to teach others and learn in the process.
You're being modest when you say that you're not chasing targets, because your organization has been one of the most enduring and scaling ventures. How big and how? What is the reach of Rangasutra today, Sumit?
Yeah. So Arti, you know, when we started with 1,000 artisans, and I don't think I shared this part of the story, is that when the banks were not lending us money, we went back to the artisans, and 1,000 artisans put in 1,000 rupees each, and that's how we got our first 10 lakhs. That was the first equity. And then I got very worried and felt very responsible that here are all these people, you know, putting their faith in this venture. So I took loans from friends and family, put in another 10 lakhs. Now, so initially we were focused with these 1,000, or I would say maybe not 1,000, 500 initially, to give them regular work.
What would you say, looking back, have been your biggest achievements, both professionally and personally?
You know, we've shown that there's a way of doing business which can benefit everyone across the chain. It can be ethical, it can be profitable, it can have a social impact. It doesn't need to squeeze one side to benefit another. That everyone can, you know, as Gandhiji said, there's enough in this world for everyone's need, but not for everyone's greed. So I think that is something that earlier we were talking about it, but you know, as in my not-for-profit world or when I started out initially, but now we've demonstrated that it can be done.
One craft that's close to your heart.
Actually it's two, I'd say knitting and hand embroidery.
One last question, what would be your advice to every woman entrepreneur out there?
Yeah, so I would say, recognize your power. I mean, it's not for nothing that we say Shakti is feminine. I really believe it. And it's not just because it's there in our, in our religious texts or in our ancient history. But I really think that, of course, I believe that all men and women have both masculine and feminine in them. So for women, I would say, recognize your strength and then go ahead and get it. Be more aggressive if needed. Don't sort of wait for things to come to you. Lean out, step up. There's a lot to be done and a lot can be done. And people will join you along the way.
What do you think it's going to take to have more women entrepreneurs start businesses and have more women entrepreneurs grow their businesses?
Yeah, so I think one of the things that you mentioned is collaboration. Collaborate in the sense that there is always, like, as I said, when I started, okay, I had a degree in economics and I had a good work, good experience in social work and social mobilization. But I knew nothing about the product we were going to work on, very little about the product. I didn't come from a design background. I didn't have any business expertise. So I managed to get such like my other people, with complementary skills. So I think that's very important, find people who bring something else to the table.
Looking forward to more thoughts, comments and discussions that will emerge from doing this virtually. And to everyone out there who's listening to this series, please invest and encourage women-led businesses and women entrepreneurs. Thank you so much, Sumita, and have a lovely day.
Thank you, Aarti. Great talking to you.